Hey everybody, thanks for tuning in to Altium Academy. I'm Zach Peterson, I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're gonna talk about the copper thickness or the copper weight that you should use in your PCB. So what value of copper weight should you use? Should you just go with your manufacturer's stack up recommendation? Should you try and figure something out yourself? Should you start looking through material data sheets and seeing what's available? We're gonna try and answer all those different questions because there's a few different trade-offs you should think about when you're selecting your copper weight. Let's go ahead and get started. Started with copper weight. Basically, if you have a PCB and you have your copper on either layer, let's just say we're on the top layer, when you look at the copper thickness in your board, we actually don't specify it as a thickness, we specify it as a weight. So we call it copper weight. Typical values for most vanilla PCBs that you'll find out there are 1 ounce per square foot. Pretty weird unit system to use, but that's okay. This is kind of a standard value that you'll find. Another really common value is 0.5 ounces per square foot. And usually when people talk about copper weight, they don't say the square foot, they'll just say 1 ounce of copper. This is what they really mean, is 1 ounce per square foot of copper. That's what the copper thickness is. And this is normally specified as being on both sides of the board. If you build out a typical stack up, like let's say your standard 4-layer stack up where you've got your first internal plane layer and then your second internal layer, and you look at the copper weight, generally a standard stack up that you'll see from a lot of manufacturers will just apply whatever value, whether it's, you know, 1/2 ounce or 1 ounce, to all of these layers. It makes it really easy to build a stack up. Most laminates are gonna come with one of these two options as a standard option, and they're just gonna press that together in their process, and bam, you've got your copper weight. This is gonna be pretty standard in every stack up. Depending on your application, you might be wondering, should I go with a different value of copper weight? What are the different values of copper weights? There are some manufacturers that do something called heavy copper. And this isn't a super common term, but heavy copper essentially refers to any value bigger than 1 ounce per square foot copper weight in your PCB stack up. That could be 2, it could be 3, could be 4, could be all the way up to like 10. You can actually find some really big values for copper weight on PCB laminates that are used in PCB stack ups. If heavy copper is gonna be used, where should you use it? Should it be in internal layers? Should it be external layers? For heavy copper being used in a plane layer, you could technically do it anywhere, as long as the manufacturer can get the different layers to bond to each other in their heating and pressing process when they build out the stack up. So if it's just a plane layer, it's essentially just gonna be uniform copper everywhere. And if it's not gonna be etched, then you get a nice uniform bond between this layer and the copper, or between this layer and the copper, and so on and so forth throughout the layer stack. Same thing on the top layer. Top layer, you can do heavy copper if you want. Or you can just go with one of the standard values. Now, there comes a little bit of a problem if you're gonna do heavy copper on like an internal layer, and let's say you're gonna go to 2 or 3 or 4 on an internal layer. If you actually look at what happens on an internal layer with heavy copper, once the pressing process starts, what they'll try and do is they will try and press this top layer down over this trace. So if you have an etched trace with heavy copper, let's say it's two ounces per square foot or larger, then what'll happen is this could leave a little bit of room around this trace, this top layer. And this gap that you get here is gonna be determined by the resin content in each of these layers. When the stack up is being created and the layers are being pressed down onto each other and heated, the resin content that is in this layer will start to flow. And ideally it will just fill in all of these cracks and fill in all these gaps, and there will be no space left over. So this can happen in your PCB if you have heavy copper traces that are etched on an internal layer. So if you have a higher resin content, so if your resin content goes up, then it's more likely to fill in these little gaps. So that's one of the reasons you shouldn't use heavy copper on an internal layer, is that it can actually decrease the peel strength of this laminated stack up. So once it's laminated, it can be peeled, although it, you know, takes some force. But if you don't have a good bond here at the copper and then at this interface around these traces, it can reduce the peel strength. So basically, the more traces you have on the internal layer, the more of these gaps you're gonna have, and then the more you're gonna have to worry about the peel strength going down. So that's what happens on the internal layer. On the external layer, go ahead and etch your heavy copper traces all day. Just make sure that if you do wanna use heavy copper or, you know, high copper weight, that the manufacturer or the fabricator that you're gonna use can actually work with it, and that has a they have a process that will work with these heavy laminates. Make sure to call them if you are gonna do that and get a standard stack up just as a starting point. Then you can start to work out if you need to use a different layer count, if you need to maybe go to two layers and just do that. It really depends. We've talked about some of the manufacturing aspects as far as what happens when you go to heavier copper, but what about current? How much current can you put through heavier copper? What about impedance? Let's say you want to do a controlled impedance line. Should you do controlled impedance with heavier or lighter copper? Well, technically, you certainly can do heavier copper and do an impedance controlled line. You just need to know how the heavier copper affects the impedance. It is true that, you know, let's say I have, just for the moment, this trace. Its impedance, Z sub zero, is a function of three things: this width, and then this height, we'll just draw it all the way down, this height between the planes, and then also the copper thickness. So we'll just call this T. So remember, the copper thickness is just a proxy for whatever the copper weight is. And you can actually convert copper weight into a thickness value. So there's actually a table in one of the articles that's linked in the description. Go check out that article. It has a handy table that you can use to convert between copper weight value and then an actual thickness. Your impedance depends on the width, the distance between the planes, and the thickness of your copper. The thickness is actually has a very weak influence on the impedance. You can actually like take the thickness and double it, go to 2T, and it's only gonna decrease Z sub zero by like, I don't know, a few ohms. Let's call it 3 ohms or so. That's just an estimate. The point is that it's a very small change. So going from, you know, 0.5 ounce to 1 ounce is not gonna have a huge effect. Now, flip this around. If you were to take W, let's say the width, and go to 2W, so double the width, you could actually get a really big drop in the impedance. So that's because when you double the width, you decrease the inductance, and by decreasing the inductance, you then decrease the impedance. Go back and review some of our videos on characteristic impedance if you want to see how the width and the inductance and then the capacitance of the trace are all related, and that'll tell you pretty much how you can calculate how the impedance changes if you do this type of transformation from, you know, the width to double the width. And then I'll let you guys work out what happens when you take the thickness and then double the layer thickness. So this is essentially what happens when you're dealing with a switch from T to 2T. You do have a slight decrease in impedance. It's not very big. You can basically not worry about it. And even if you were worried about like a 2 or 3, you know, ohm drop in impedance, you can do an adjustment on W and it'll make up for it. And it's not gonna be a very big adjustment. So you can still hit your controlled impedance. So generally, if you are working with controlled impedance and you're wondering, hey, should I use heavier copper? The typical practice is to just go with the default copper weight. If you're dealing with a board that needs heavier copper, it's usually not gonna be a board that also needs controlled impedance. It's usually a board that's operating at high temperature or at high current. And in some boards where you're working with like a high power power electronics, those two things kind of go together. So you could be operating at high current just because you need to supply current somewhere, but you could also be operating at high temperature because you're working with components that have some, you know, they're gonna have some resistive drop, and that's gonna cause some of that energy that is being carried by your currents to then get converted into heat, causes your board to heat up. And so that's another reason that you might like to use heavier copper. So there's actually a table in the IPC standards that you can use to figure out what is the trace width and thickness, and rather the copper weight, that you would need in order to ensure that your trace's temperature rise does not exceed too large of a value. So basically the way this works is you pick your current target that you know you're gonna use, and then You pick a temperature rise limit that you can tolerate, and then you figure out what the copper weight is, and you figure out the width. So I'm gonna show you all how to do that right now.
Okay, everybody. So what we're looking at right here is an example from the IPC standard. So this is the IPC 2152 standard nomograph that you can use to relate the conductor width. They have it here in inches to a cross-sectional area if you want. But really what matters here is the copper weight, which you can see in each of these lines. And then you have an allowed temperature rise that you'd like to hit, and the current that the wire carries. So you can use this to figure out the width of a conductor that you need. So I have these lines drawn on here just kind of as two examples, and so I'll walk through those. So if I just zoom in here to the conductor width, here, let's just say we have a 0.15 inch wide trace, so 150 mils, okay? So if we trace over here to our copper weight of 1 ounce per square foot, and then trace up here to 10 degrees Celsius, and then trace over here to the left, we can see that we would have about, I call it about 2.75 amps that this particular trace could carry, okay? This is a pretty conservative number, but basically what this is telling you is if you take this trace and run it at 2.75 amps, it should rise, or its temperature should rise by about 10 degrees C. Okay, so you notice we started over here with the conductor width and then got back to a current. So if we like, we could have said, well, you know, maybe we want to go up to 6 amps. Okay, so if I start on this same track, go over here to my 1 ounce per square foot copper, and then I go all the way up here to the line with 6 amps, you'll see it intersects with this curve that corresponds to 45 degrees Celsius, okay? So in that particular case, we would expect if we run this same 150 mil wide trace at 6 amps, its temperature would rise by 45 degrees C with respect to ambient, okay? So these are temperature rise values, not absolute temperature values. You could also go the other way, and that's what this other orange line shows. So here we just started with a current, and then we said, okay, with our 1 amp of current, I don't want to have the temperature rise any more than 30 degrees C. So that's what this this middle curve shows, okay? And if I have, in that case, 1/2 ounce per square foot copper, then I would need to have this trace be, this is about 40 or so mils wide. So that's what these different lines mean. So you can really just trace this out for anything you like. Now, these are a bit conservative. They only apply to one specific material system, and they don't say anything about whether or not you have traces above or below. And also, you really don't need to worry about this cross-sectional thing. Nobody really uses it. People just use the width of the conductor and then the copper weight. Okay, so what you can immediately see, or you should be able to immediately see, is that for a given conductor width, if I go over to a higher copper weight and then I trace up to a given temperature rise, so here at 10, I could carry a larger current, just like I would expect. Okay, so this is, you know, kind of our justification, or at least our experimental justification for using heavier copper to carry higher current. And that all makes sense. So the article that we'll link in the description actually has this particular graphic in it. You can use that as your own starting point for estimating the current that a conductor can carry. Just note that like if you're in Altium Designer, one thing that you can do is you can use the PDN analyzer extension. That extension you can use to determine the power loss in a conductor as it's operating with a given current, and from that you could actually determine what the temperature rise might be. So that's a really useful tool you could use. Now if you're inside Altium Designer and you create a brand new PCB, what you can do is you can open up the Layer Stack Manager. And once you get inside the Layer Stack Manager, you'll be able to actually set the copper weight that you want on each layer. So right now, just by default, it comes up with 1 ounce. They mean 1 ounce per square foot. Here, you know, you click on this drop-down menu, and you've got a whole lot of options. So from here, you can edit your stack up. Now, if you're creating your own stack up, obviously send it over to your fabricator and just check with them, ask them, hey, what's your standard stack up? Or, you know, can you create this stack up? And they'll be able to verify it for you. But from here, you know, just set whatever copper weight you like, or that you've been given from your fabricator. If you're a circuit maker user, same thing. There's a layer stack manager. You'll see a window that looks just like this. It'll just be on a white background or a gray background, and you'll be able to do the exact same thing. Just click the drop-down menu and select your copper weight that you want on your board.
That particular chart from the IPC 2152 standard is frankly not very accurate. I've actually been in conversations with someone who is part of the original working group that worked on developing those charts, and the people who worked on it at the time, and I think anyone who can, you know, think about how material properties affect thermal performance, they knew that that particular chart was only applicable to one material system and one particular type of stack up. If you start placing copper above and below, depending on the extent of the copper, it's going to modify what the allowed temperature rise is going to be for a given width and copper weight. And so all of those factors need to be taken into account. So you can look at that chart as kind of like the least bad tool that we have to start sizing out conductors for a particular current level that you need to carry in your traces. So I say least bad because it's a little over conservative. I think a lot of people would agree that it's a bit over conservative, and it doesn't apply to every material system. So if you're going to use that table, that's perfectly fine. Just go ahead and make sure that you keep that in mind. If you go to a different material system, such as one that has a higher thermal conductivity, you can actually use a little bit larger current, and vice versa. If you have to settle with a material system that has lower thermal conductivity, you have to then settle for somewhat lower current. The other option is you have to make your traces larger in order to accommodate a certain current in your board. So that's really important in power electronics, because if you're doing power electronics and you need to route some conductor that carries current, you need to make sure that it's sized properly so that it doesn't heat up too much. Now, that current needs to be delivered to all your other components. You need to make sure that it's sized properly and it doesn't take up too much space on your board. So that's the other challenge. Some of the stuff that we've been talking about so far with the IPC 2152 nomograph, that particular table was developed for traces. So what about planes? So we'll come back and we'll talk about planes and how much current they can carry and how to work with power planes in an upcoming video. So stay tuned. All right, everybody. So again, go check out the blog link in the description. There's a nice little table in there that can be used to convert between your copper weight values and the actual thickness of the copper film. If you don't have it memorized, that's okay. There's a table in there that you can use. So hit that like button, hit the subscribe button. As always, leave your questions in the comment section and I will do my best to get to them. I know I was slacking the last couple of weeks, but I'll get to them as fast as I can, folks. All right, thanks everybody. And definitely on this stuff, don't forget to call your fabricator.